Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the McGowan Theater, located in the National Archives Building in Washington, D.C. I'm Doug Swanson, Visitor Services Manager for the National Archives Museum, and also the producer of the Noontime Lecture Series. Before we begin today's program, I just have a couple of reminders of upcoming events that might interest you. On Saturday, March 14th, we'll be screening the 1931 classic film, The Public Enemy, starring James Cagney, whose character becomes involved in the criminal underworld in Prohibition-era America. This film is being shown in conjunction with our brand new exhibit, Spirited Republic, Alcohol in American History, which can be seen in the O'Brien Gallery on the main exhibit floor until January 10th of 2016. On Tuesday, March 24th at noon, Mark A. Klingler will be on hand to discuss his book, A Field Guide to the Natural World of Washington, D.C. This is part of our partnership with the annual Environmental Film Festival and also the National Cherry Blossom Festival. To find out more about these and our other public programs and events, you can take one of our monthly event calendars, which you'll find in the racks in the theater lobby, or else you can visit our website at www.archives.gov/calendar. Our topic for today is The Great Divide, the conflict between Washington and Jefferson that defined a nation, by Thomas Fleming. Mr. Fleming is an historian and historical novelist with a special interest in the American Revolution. After graduating from St. Peter's Preparatory School in Jersey City, Mr. Fleming spent a year in the United States Navy. He received a bachelor's degree with honors from Fordham University in 1950. After brief stints as a newspaper man and magazine editor, he became a full-time writer in 1960. His first history book, Now We Are Enemies, an account of the Battle of Bunker Hill, was published that same year. It was an instant success and featured as a main selection of the Literary Guild. Since then, he has published numerous books about events and figures of the Revolutionary Era, biographies of Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, and other periods of American history. He's also published more than 20 novels, including several bestsellers set against various historical backgrounds. A frequent guest on C-SPAN, PBS, A&E, and the History Channel, Mr. Fleming was a consultant and commentator on the PBS series, The Irish in America, Long Journey Home, and wrote the companion volume to another PBS series, Liberty, the American Revolution. He contributes articles to such magazines as American Heritage, Military History, History Today, and the Quarterly Journal of Military History. He has served as president of the Society of American Historians and the Penn American Center. He also spent 10 years as chairman of the New York American Revolutionary Roundtable and is an honorary member of the New York State Society of the Cincinnati. Please join me in welcoming Thomas Fleming to the National Archives.
Good afternoon. What a great pleasure to be here. There's something about the subject of this book that makes it very, very suitable for this to be my first chance to talk about it to an audience. And I hope we'll have a good conversation before we part. It opens, my speech does at any rate, not the book, with a question, a conflict between George Washington and Thomas Jefferson. Most Americans are unaware that such a discord ever existed. Numerous historians have explored Jefferson's clashes with Alexander Hamilton, but little has been written about the differences that developed between the two most famous founding fathers. 2 years after her husband's death, Martha Washington told a visiting congressman that the two worst days of her life were, one, the day that George died, and two, the day that Thomas Jefferson came to pay his condolences. There is little doubt that Martha was reflecting her husband's opinion of Mr. Jefferson. She may also have known that Jefferson's dislike of Washington had grown so intense he avoided attending his funeral, even though he was vice president at the time. A series of political disagreements had gradually destroyed the friendship and mutual respect the two men had enjoyed at the start of Washington's presidency. Ultimately, they became enemies, political enemies. Small, slight James Madison whose brilliant political theorizing won the admiration of both men, was forced to choose between these two tall antagonists, and that's one of the underlying dramas of the book. 11 years older than Jefferson, Washington had almost no formal education. He spent his teenage years as a hard-working surveyor. Jefferson devoured books and ideas at the College of William and Mary. At the age of 22, Washington went to war against the French and Indians in the Western wilderness and eventually became Virginia's best-known soldier. Jefferson studied law and became a passionate revolutionist when America's grievances against Britain's rule exploded into rebellion. During the eight-year struggle for independence, Washington became a man who lived dangerously. This is a word that came to me while I was working on this book, and it sums up to me so much of Washington's life. Surmounting defeats and attempted betrayals by fellow revolutionists, Washington rose to worldwide fame as the commander of the American Continental Army, as it was called. He crowned his victory by rejecting pleas to banish the bankrupt Continental Congress, bankrupt in more ways than one, intellectually as well as financially, and become the new nation's military dictator. Instead, he quietly resigned his commission and became a private citizen again. Jefferson's chief contribution to the struggle was, I think we all know, drafting the Declaration of Independence. The opening paragraph's soaring insistence that every human being was entitled to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness would ultimately give the document world-transforming power. I recently did some research that gave me the background for those two words, world-transforming. After the Declaration of Independence, over the next 100 or 150 years, over 200 similar declarations were issued by countries around the world. It really does testify to Jefferson's power to encapsulate the struggle for freedom. But few people emphasized this aspect of the Declaration or thought of Jefferson as its author during the War for Independence. For one thing, it was kept a deep secret because it was a hanging offense if the British captured him. During the war, Jefferson was known for his 2 years as governor of Virginia, 1779 to 81, during which he revealed a dismaying inability to deal with the crises that confronted him and an almost morbid sensitivity to criticism. Let's say in defense of him that Virginia and the rest of the country was bankrupt by that time, and there was no easy answer to the crises that confronted him. Nevertheless, Jefferson didn't react well to them. And when a spokesman for Patrick Henry suggested Governor Jefferson's performance deserved a reprimand from the Virginia legislature, Washington told his friend James Madison that he would never again hold public office. The difference between this and Washington and what he put up with in the 8 years of the struggle for independence is kind of almost stunning. By 1783, when independence was confirmed by a peace treaty with Great Britain, it had become apparent to many thoughtful men that the Continental Congress and the primitive Constitution it had created, the Articles of Confederation, were totally inadequate to the challenge of governing 13 contentious states. And boy, were they contentious. In September 1785, Congressman James Madison began visiting General Washington at Mount Vernon to discuss the need for a more effective federal government. Absent from these conversations, which would have a large influence on the as yet unborn Constitution, was Washington and Madison's mutual friend, Thomas Jefferson. He was in France, serving as America's envoy. Washington was first, last, and always a political realist. We must take human nature as we find it. Perfection falls not to the share of mortals, was one of his favorite maxims. But he combined this realism with a surprisingly strong faith that America was destined to become a beacon of freedom for men and women everywhere. That, more than anything else, explains his resignation at the end of the war. One recent biographer has called him a realistic visionary, and I think it's the best summary of him that I've come across. Jefferson tended to see men and events through the lens of a pervasive idealism. He believed that if left to their own devices, free men would inevitably find the path to a good government. He didn't even think it was necessary. All they needed was visionary words to inspire their path to this key to happiness. But experience had convinced Washington that this happy outcome was only going to occur with the help of strong leadership. This was the missing ingredient in the Articles of Confederation, which had made Congress the sole ruler of the nation. Jefferson found no fault with this arrangement. Congress and the voice of the people were sort of synonymous in his mind. At the Constitutional Convention that grew out of Washington talks with Madison, the ex-general convinced the delegates that the new government needed a president with real power, someone who could speak and act as a co-equal to Congress. I think we sometimes take for granted what an achievement this was. I remember I once had the privilege of spending 2 weeks with President Harry Truman. I was working on a biography of him. And he remarked to me at one point that he thought the American presidency was the greatest political achievement of the mind of man. And he was a man who studied American history pretty carefully. And this is what the Constitutional Convention gave General Washington, or he was ex-General Washington by this time. James Madison later recalled, "No one signed the Constitution with more enthusiasm than General Washington." Washington subsequently played a central role in the debate over ratifying the Constitution. Again and again, he was asked to use his behind-the-scenes influence to persuade wavering states, notably his own Virginia, where Patrick Henry was a passionate foe of the Constitution. Thanks to him, they approved the new charter, and without Virginia, it would have been all over. They did it by 3 votes. It was so, and Madison was responsible. He debated with Patrick Henry, urged on by Washington, of course, in deep background, and did a marvelous job. But it was a mighty close call. Ambassador Jefferson missed this entire struggle. In France, he was absorbed in another drama, the first rumblings of what became the French Revolution. When he read a copy of the Constitution, which one of the delegates sent him, Jefferson's reaction was strikingly different from Washington's. "I must confess, there are things in it that stagger all my disposition to subscribe to it," Jefferson told John Adams, who was ambassador to London at the time. Jefferson was especially critical of the office of the presidency. He thought it was much too powerful. He called it a bad addition of a Polish king. Now, that sounds like an insult to the Polish people. It wasn't. But a Polish king was elected, then he served for life, like all kings. And this is what Jefferson was saying about the presidency. He was convinced that they were never going to give up this office once they got their mitts on it, because it was so powerful. And Jefferson stayed in France for the first part of Washington's presidency. Washington was the inevitable choice to be the first president. When he was officially informed of his election, he promised to bring to the office what he called honest zeal. The words are very significant. There are books that maintain that Washington really didn't administer the government. He merely presided and let Hamilton and Jefferson and other people fight it out. Those words, I think, refute this widely held opinion. Nothing could be more erroneous, in my opinion. Virtually from his first day in office, Washington made clear his intention to govern, to lead the nation. One of his first acts was to send a letter to the principal nations of Europe, informing them as they wish to communicate with the United States of America, they should write to him, President Washington, not Congress. Meanwhile, in France, Thomas Jefferson was becoming a passionate advocate of the French Revolution. When he returned to America and accepted Washington's offer to become his Secretary of State, he was soon on the prowl for anyone who was hostile to France. Vice President Adams became the first target of his wrath when Adams published a series of essays predicting disaster for the makeshift government that the French were creating. And I should add that Jefferson was a key advisor in some of the early stages of the French Revolution, where he was very intimate with the Marquis de Lafayette. Far, far more serious was Secretary of State Jefferson's disagreement with Secretary of the Treasury Alexander Hamilton's plan to pay the nation's Revolutionary War debt, which amounted in today's money to almost $1 billion, by creating a Bank of the United States and selling shares to it, in it to wealthy investors. Jefferson, and I fear many others, saw the similarity to the Bank of England and the rest of Britain's financial system. Jefferson's hatred of Britain was so intense, and again, I'm not just blaming Jefferson for this, it was a widespread feeling throughout the country. Jefferson and his, I guess you'd say, followers by now, saw the plan as a virtual betrayal of the ideals of our revolution. He also disagreed violently with Hamilton's argument as there were implied powers in the Constitution that permitted the federal government to create a bank. Jefferson saw this as a first and ultimately fatal step to tyranny. He would have loved Justice Scalia. Jefferson was a strict constructionist, as strict as you could get. President Washington had no such antagonism to Britain. There's a wonderful story that I found when I did a book on the Battle of Yorktown. After the battle was over, Washington gave a dinner for the captured British officers. And one of them, who had quite a lot of nerve, and they all started offering toast, picked up his glass and said, "To the King!" And Washington picked up his glass and said, "To the King of England. Confine him there, and I'll drink him a full bumper." Britain, as far as Washington was concerned, Hamilton's system, that it was similar to Britain's, was irrelevant. Now, it started to restore America's ruined credit abroad and created prosperity at home. Here might be a little chance to jump ahead. In Washington's two terms, salaries in the capital city of Philadelphia for workers on the docks and places like that doubled. How do you like that? If that wasn't a system that worked, I don't know what was. But Jefferson argued that this success was too high. It was breeding corruption and the creation of a wealthy upper class. America should remain a nation of farmers. This was the only way they could hope to preserve the purity of the country's morals. The Secretary of State had an almost pathological hostility to life in large cities, which he saw as virtual incubators of immorality and corruption. And that's why when his presidency began, he loved Washington, D.C., because it was a village in those days. And the population was about 4,000 people. But he just adored it. It realized one of his dreams. Washington's backing soon persuaded Congress to vote their approval of Hamilton's financial system. Jefferson did not react well to this defeat. He talked of Virginia merchants rushing to Philadelphia to participate in the booming stock market, eager to acquire their share of what Jefferson called federal filth. When the Bank of the United States announced plans to establish a branch in Virginia, Jefferson's reaction was incredibly extreme. In a raging letter to James Madison, he told him that any Virginian who did business with this bank, which had been established by, quote unquote, a foreign power, he meant the U.S. federal government, would be committing treason against their native state and deserved to be tried and executed for the crime. He got carried away, Jefferson did. There's no doubt about it. By this time, both Jefferson and Madison had convinced themselves that President Washington had become totally subservient to Secretary of the Treasury Hamilton. In fact, as I demonstrate in the book, in their various disputes, Washington sided with Hamilton about 50% of the time and supported Jefferson's views on numerous other issues. Jefferson and Madison decided it was time to find a spokesman who would tell the truth about the dangerous direction in which they saw the nation heading. They found him in the person of Philip Freneau, a classmate of Madison's at Princeton, which was then called the College of New Jersey. Jefferson hired Freneau as a translator for the State Department, and the two men helped him launch an aggressive newspaper, the National Gazette. Issue after issue attacked Hamilton and his program. It was a unique situation, to which Jefferson seemed to be able to adjust his conscience. He was secretly financing and encouraging savage criticism of President George Washington's administration, in which he was supposedly a loyal member. It did not take long for Freneau to begin including Washington as one of his targets. In Washington's papers, I found three anonymous letters which described the entire Jefferson-Madison-Freneau operation. The writer warned Washington that Jefferson's goal was to succeed him as president. It's more than a little significant that President Washington saved these letters. They suggest, among other things, that he knew exactly what was happening inside his cabinet. Meanwhile, events in France added new tensions to Jefferson's relationship with the president. Radicals known as Jacobins seized control of the revolution, guillotined King Louis XVI, and declared war on England. Washington swiftly decided that America must and would remain neutral and prepared a proclamation urging all Americans to refrain from acts of violence favoring either side. Here again, you see Washington announcing very quietly and subtly that the president was in control of foreign policy. He saw this as the only way to do it. You could not let Congress get mixed up in it. Alas, we've forgotten that lesson. Jefferson objected vehemently to this neutrality proclamation. He wanted President Washington to call Congress into session and ask them to vote on whether to issue it. He connected it to whether the Congress's right to declare war. The Secretary of State was hoping that they'd repudiate the president, but Washington told him he had ample power, he was citing the implied power, to issue the proclamation independently. In Paris, meanwhile, the drift toward blood-soaked tragedy gathered momentum. Soon the Jacobins had total control of the government. They formed a Committee of Public Safety under the leadership of fanatic Maximilian Robespierre. He proclaimed a new motto: the Republic consists in the extermination of everything that opposes it. In Paris, as well as Lyon and other cities, massacre became the order of the day. Secretary of State Jefferson remained incredibly oblivious to the moral collapse of France's government. He repeatedly dismissed stories about it in American newspapers as British propaganda. He found it more difficult, however, to ignore letters from his former secretary, William Short, who had remained in Europe when Jefferson returned to America. Jefferson's irritation with Short's letters soon exploded into a rebuke. "The tone of your letters," he said, "has for some time given me pain on account of the extreme warmth with which you censor the proceedings of the Jacobins of France." Why didn't Short understand that Jefferson considered them the same as with the Republican patriots of America? Republican was the name that Jefferson gave his new party, which was definitely an opposition party. Today we call them Democratic Republicans because they're the ancestors of the Democrats. Even more amazing was what followed this sanctification of men who were ready and willing to commit mass murder. In the struggle to expunge King Louis XVI, Jefferson noted that innocent as well as guilty people had died. He mourned the innocent, he said, as if they had died in battle. What enabled him to tolerate their loss was the goal of the struggle. The liberty of the whole earth was depending on the issue of this contest. Rather than it should have failed, I would have seen half the earth desolated. Were there but an Adam and Eve left in every country and left free, it would be better than it now is. How's that for extremism? The only man I ever met who went as far as that was a Serbian psychiatrist. I once did a tour of Yugoslavia before it collapsed into separate countries. And he told me that it was absolutely essential for the Serbs to get an atomic bomb. And he said, if there are only two Serbs left after a nuclear war, that would be a victory. It shows how these diseases in the public mind can communicate across the century. This was the ultimate example, in Jefferson's case, of his readiness to go to extremes in the grip of strong political emotions. Meanwhile, in America, the Secretary of State found himself face to face with the revolution in person and in the name of red-haired Charles Edmond Genet, the new ambassador for the French Republic. In private conversations with Genet, Jefferson abandoned all pretensions to neutrality. Jefferson gave me useful notions on men in office, Genet told his superiors in Paris. He did not at all conceal from me that Secretary of the Treasury Hamilton had the greatest influence over the president's mind. Imagine a Secretary of State telling this and accusing the Secretary of the Treasury. It just shows the distance that Jefferson could travel once he got in the grip of strong emotions. And unfortunately, he was dealing with a guy whose strong emotions equaled his. The headstrong Genet was soon referring to the president as Old Man Washington. He began commissioning privateers sailing from American ports to seize British ships at sea as if the proclamation of neutrality did not exist. Genet also boldly conferred with Secretary of State Jefferson about plans to persuade Kentucky to seize Spanish-held Florida and New Orleans and create a new independent nation in the West. The Secretary of State saw nothing wrong with fracturing the American Union this way. President Washington was appalled. He issued orders to General Anthony Wayne, who commanded an army in the Western states, to post guards on all the main rivers going down to the New Orleans and stop anybody who had a gun in his hand. The president was even less enthused by Jefferson's support of Philip Freneau. He worshipped Genet too. In one issue, his paper featured a cartoon of President Washington strapped to a board being carried toward the waiting blades of a guillotine. Washington soon revealed his ability to play an equally rough political game. In a New York newspaper, Chief Justice John Jay leaked, that's that Supreme Court justice, he leaked, no doubt, with the president's approval, I think, a statement by Genet that he was going to appeal over the heads of Old Man Washington to the American people. A huge explosion of anger swept all the states of the Union. Pledges of devotion to the president poured into Philadelphia, which was the capital then, from mass meetings in cities and towns and villages everywhere. Soon, the president was able to ask his Secretary of State to request Envoy Genet's recall. And there's a nice little footnote or endnote to that one. Genet realized that if he went back to France, the first thing he'd do was lose his head, because the total extremists were now in charge over there. And guess what? Washington gave him asylum and allowed him to live for the rest of his life in the United States. This defeat of Genet was a significant turning point in Jefferson's relationship with Washington. He was forced to admit to himself and his followers that any attempt to challenge the president's leadership was very likely to be ruinous. That left Jefferson with only one alternative. He somehow had to convince Washington that Hamilton and the men around him were secretly plotting to change the American government into some version of a monarchy. Three times, the two men sat down and argued about this crucial issue. Each time, Washington was unconvinced. Surprise, surprise. He insisted Jefferson and his followers were conjuring a hobgoblin. which did not exist and never would exist in the United States of America. And I think he was right. As the argument continued, tempers became strained. The president began to accuse Jefferson of having a low opinion of his intelligence, which I fear was probably the case. He testily insisted he was the last man in the world who would tolerate the emergence of an American king. Finally, the brilliant graduate of the College of William and Mary had to admit that the man with little more than a grammar school education was winning the argument. Jefferson's response was his resignation as Secretary of State. Out of office, Jefferson declared, a la his style when he was governor of Virginia, that he was through with politics. In fact, he wrote letter after letter to his lieutenants, Madison and James Monroe, advising them on how to oppose President Washington's policies. In state after state, Jefferson's followers began founding what they called democratic societies. They were modeled on the Jacobin clubs of Paris, which had enabled the Jacobins to take over the French Revolution. These American versions preached opposition and even revolution against Washington's government, not at all in all parts of the country. But there was a movement in western Pennsylvania to secede from the Union, taking the western sections of nearby states such as Virginia and North Carolina with them. The pretext for their defiance was the federal government's tax on whiskey, which the Pennsylvanians denounced as unjust. And to some extent, they were right about that. They made almost all their money from the wheat and other grain that they raised by distilling it into booze. But the solution was not secession from the Union. However, it really began to seize their minds. An orator wearing, he was a lawyer by trade, but he was wearing the uniform of a major general, and he addressed a huge crowd in a field a few miles from Pittsburgh, which was a little tiny village at the time. He called for the formation of a rebel army and assured his listeners that the British in Canada were ready and eager to finance their adventure. President Washington's response was swift and decisive, as befitted a man who lived dangerously. He summoned 13,000 militia from nearby states and placed Governor Henry Lee of Virginia, the most famous cavalryman of the American Revolution, in command. Washington personally accompanied this formidable army to make it clear that they spoke for his determination to crush this threat to the Union as swiftly and as thoroughly as possible. Any and all resistance evaporated. Washington returned to Philadelphia and, in a no-nonsense speech to Congress, blamed the crisis on the democratic societies who were very thick out there in western Pennsylvania. Jefferson and his followers were outraged. Oh, they beat their breasts. They accused Washington of attacking freedom of speech, and to some extent they had a point, but few people listened to them. The democratic societies within 2 years were extinct. Jefferson, meanwhile, was telling all his friends that Washington had marched 13,000 men over the mountains in search of a revolution and found none. President Washington had inspired the American people. Really, it was a huge burst of enthusiasm to join him in defeating one of the greatest threats to the Union that the nation would face until a civil war. It was a crucial step in his ongoing commitment to create a strong presidency and an featured by an unbreakable Union. In a few months, this commitment faced another test. Chief Justice John Jay had negotiated a new commercial treaty with England that was far from perfect. About the only positive advantage it offered America was a promise to evacuate 6 or 7 forts in the American West, from which they had supplied restless Indians with weapons and encouragement to drive the Americans east of the Appalachian Mountains. Washington grimly admitted the document's many defects, and he focused on its title, a treaty of amity. Those words meant that signing it would prevent a ruinous war with Britain. In a few hours, the treaty was on its way to the Senate with his signature on it, and it won their approval. Presidents Washington's decision triggered another huge uproar. Jefferson said the treaty was nothing less than an alliance between Britain and the Anglo men, as he called the British supporters of this country, against the people of the United States. Washington turned to Alexander Hamilton and asked him to defend the treaty in a series of trenchant articles that soon changed thousands of minds. As the agitation subsided, Washington delivered his annual message to Congress. The Jeffersonians expected another angry lecture that would echo the president's wrath at the democratic societies. Instead, to their amazement, President Washington smiled at his astonished listeners and congratulated them on the happiness that their country was experiencing by remaining at peace while Europe was racked by war. It dawned on Madison and other listeners that they were dealing with the master politician of his era. I've given you only a sample of the surprises that fill the pages of the Great Divide. At least as interesting are the chapters that cover Thomas Jefferson's presidency. I call him our first un-Washington president. Everything he said and did was the opposite of Washington's style and policies. For instance, instead of addressing Congress each year, he did give an inaugural talk to them, of course. Jefferson sent a message which was read by what I call a droning clerk. For over 100 years, other presidents imitated this example. Instead of leading Congress with words and acts, Jefferson led from behind, working with key congressmen in private dinners at his residence to persuade them to give him what he wanted. Thus, he created the illusion that Congress was running the country, a very, very bad idea which he inserted back into the American mind. At times, President Jefferson revealed a virtual indifference to the Constitution. In 1804, after a tremendous election victory, thanks to his acquiring the territory of Louisiana, in which I might add that we don't have time to get into it, but I might add that he did resort to the implied powers of the Constitution in order to buy Louisiana. Although he kept talking about getting everybody to pass a constitutional amendment to legalize it, but they finally, please keep quiet, Mr. President, or Napoleon is going to give up on the whole thing. And that's a separate drama, I see. But in 1804, after this huge victory, that made Jefferson so enormously popular, the Louisiana Purchase, that it remained popular. It even survived the Civil War into the post-Civil War days. And there's a biography. I wrote a very interesting book called The Intimate Lives of the Founding Fathers. And in there, I cite this biographer who wrote in the 1870s. And he summed up Jefferson's popularity in his mind by saying, if Jefferson is right, America's right. If Jefferson is wrong, America is wrong. From what you've heard so far, wouldn't you say this is a recipe for disaster? But at any rate, the big result of, let me go back again. I started to say, in 1804, with this huge victory, thanks to Louisiana, he attempted to impeach a very hostile Supreme Court Justice, Samuel Chase, who frequently gave speeches from the bench denouncing Jefferson's administration. Jefferson's spokesman in Congress declared that any judge of the Supreme Court could and should be replaced by a majority vote of Congress. They were for abolishing life tenure. The will of the majority, this was the phrase that Jefferson absolutely adored, should be the supreme law of the land. One result of Jefferson's presidential policies was the virtual disappearance of the memory of George Washington's presidency. Jefferson praised Washington in his first inaugural address as our first and greatest revolutionary character, but he carefully omitted any and all recognition of any details of Washington as a political leader. Jefferson had already dismissed Washington's farewell address with its insistence on the importance of the Union in the nation's future. He saw nothing wrong with what he called Cision, C-I-S-S-I-O-N, his word for secession, if the citizens of a state decided the federal government was trespassing on their rights. He saw Washington's warning against excessive favoritism to a foreign country, one of the key ideas of the farewell address, as a personal attack on his, Jefferson's, support of revolutionary France. And on that, he was 100% right. The central issue about which the two men quarreled, the vital importance of a president with the strength and talent to lead the country and a Congress with the ability to work with this president simultaneously, that has refused to disappear. It's raging right now in Washington, D.C. It's still with us, as I said, in Washington, D.C. I hope the readers of the first of The Great Divide will find some enlightenment as well as wisdom in this exploration of a subject that remains crucial to the happiness and prosperity of the United States of America. Thanks so much for listening. Thank you. I'll be happy to take questions. And I was asked to remind everybody, if they have a question, you've got to go over to one side where the microphones are. You can't just speak from the center of the audience. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So, yes, sir.
I've always been curious about Jefferson's resignation. Can you give us any more details as to actually what happened?
Jefferson's resignation as Secretary of State?
Yeah, as Secretary of State. What exactly happened? Did Washington give him a little nudge? Or?
No, he didn't. He did everything in his power to try to retain him as Secretary of State, and for a very good reason. As I said, Washington was the master politician of his era, and by this time, Jefferson had this political party behind him, and Washington saw that having Jefferson in his cabinet was brilliant political cover for him. If he could keep him in the cabinet, he would, you know, Jefferson would have to be talking every day, objecting to this and that. He wouldn't do it, of course. So he really tried to keep him in the cabinet, and but Jefferson was absolutely insistent. He said he had a headache. He could come up with a million reasons why he just couldn't function anymore. And I think there was some truth to it, incidentally. He was a very delicately built, constructive man. And so that Jefferson went home to Monticello.
Thank you.
Yes. Yeah, you're welcome. Next. We'll be right with you, gentlemen.
Did Jefferson suffer from depression? Was he migraines and real emotional problems?
Yes, Jefferson definitely suffered from what he called the headache, H-E-A-D-A-C-H-E, and it was a disease. You know, when he became troubled, the headache announced itself, and once he got one of these headaches, he was immobilized for as long as a week. He couldn't talk. He couldn't sleep. It was a real problem with him, you know. And so that was something that he had to deal with, and people had to deal with it throughout his career as a politician.
He said that affected his performance as a governor of Virginia. A lot of people have said that kind of depression and migraine, and that he was so ineffective as a governor.
I didn't see so much of that in his years as governor of Virginia. A lot of the headache began after his wife died. He felt very guilty about her death. She died in 1782, and she also let him know, if I may say so, that she blamed him in part for her death. She told him that she hoped he would never marry again. And this was very nasty thing to say to a man of that period, because death was a very common occurrence in mid-years in 1780s. And she was basically saying, you claim to be in love with me, but most of the time you were playing politics. So this is my answer to you. Suffer a little. And so I think that, too, contributed to Jefferson's occasional bouts of illness and so.
Thank you.
And now we have some questions over here.
Yes, sir. If I could ask your perspective on two things that puzzled me when I visited London not long ago, that there's a statue of George Washington at the top of Trafalgar Square, and also that there was an exhibit at the Bank of England indicating that through the Revolutionary War, George and Martha Washington continued to be shareholders in the Bank of England and actually sent a courier to receive their dividends. And the third aspect of that would be whether...
Let's go one at a time.
Yes, sir.
The statue of Washington in Trafalgar Square is a tribute to the huge popularity of George Washington from the day that even before the British signed the peace treaty. John Jay was over in London for over a year, and he came back with this very imperfect treaty, and he said, if it wasn't for the fact that George Washington was the man standing behind this treaty, you couldn't believe how bad it would be, because he is the most popular figure in America, in England, outside of King George III. And so there's no doubt about the fact that the British, it's a British tradition. They love a man who can fight honorably and beat them, you know, and they recognize a lot of that talent in Washington. Now, as for the next question about, are you saying he had stock in the Bank of England?
Well, apparently
he was president?
Apparently it was acquired actually during the Revolutionary War. It was apparently acquired.
How could he acquire it during the Revolution? Well, would anybody that crazy?
Be
that crazy?
It was inherited from Martha's side of the family,
I can only, he may have inherited a lot of something as a piece of paper, but he wasn't aware of it as a stock that he was worried over or trying to cash in on or anything like that. He had a lot of other things on his mind while he was fighting the Revolutionary War. I have never heard of this before, and I congratulate you for bringing up an interesting point, but I don't think it's a very serious one.
I'll be pleased to share a photograph I took of actually they had a correspondence signed by George and Martha on display in the Bank of England Museum, showing that they sent a courier to receive their dividends.
Martha, this would be after the war.
No, I don't believe so.
It wouldn't bother him after the war to have stock in the Bank of England. It was a legitimate operation, and I didn't get to it in my talk, but I have a very important chapter in the book. It's called The Transformation of James Madison, and after Jefferson left office, Madison was stuck with fighting the War of 1812. He fought this Jeffersonian War, and it was the most incredible disaster in the history of the country. And after that, Madison started rethinking things, and he started telling people that we have to have a trained regular army, which of course Jefferson claimed we didn't need, and things like that. And then he said, oh, by this time, Madison allowed the Bank of the United States to expire in 1810 or 11, and so they didn't have it. And the country became so bankrupt that they didn't have the money to pay the clerks to the government. And so when Madison became president, he was still president, rather, for a year after the war, and he announced that the one thing they had to do in order to restore financial stability to the country was start another Bank of the United States, and he said, and it should be modeled on the Bank of England. So now, can we be shocked that Washington was doing business with the Bank of England?
Yes, I won't persist.
I think we've done enough on this.
Yes, sir.
There's two gentlemen behind
Understood.
You with questions.
Just it points towards a recurring theme in our history that
listen to the question behind you?
Of course.
I think it's a very interesting point, and I'm glad you brought it up. Yes, sir.
Hi. I think there's kind of a mistaken opinion on a lot of parts of Americans that the founding fathers were all of one voice and one goal, and I think your book and your talk today shows that that's not true.
I'm sorry, I'm not quite hearing.
Okay, let me do it again. I think there's a feeling, a mistaken feeling, on the part of Americans today that the founding fathers were all of one goal and one voice.
Oh, absolutely.
Right. And your book and your talk today, of course, accurately dispels that.
Yes.
So I kind of have two related questions to that. One is, as a historian, do you think the period of the Revolution was more contentious, or what we see today as we look up and down Pennsylvania Avenue? One point. And the second would be, if in some strange way Washington and Jefferson could come back and witness what's going on, what would please them and displease them both as individuals and political figures?
Yeah. Well, the first question, there are episodes in the course of the revolution that were definitely as contentious as we've had in our politics today. I don't think we really want to get into too many of them, but they tried to impeach some of the ambassadors we sent to England, to France. Benjamin Franklin was unbelievably abused by John Adams and other people in the government, because they said he was too pro-French. You can find Americans didn't change their nature or their readiness to attack each other. There's no question about it in the Revolution, and it's still going on today. There's no doubt about it. Now, the question of what Washington and Jefferson would think if they came back, it staggers the mind what they would think. I think the first thing, Washington would be immensely pleased by the fact that we've survived and become this continental nation with the Union intact. He thought that was the key to the happiness, the future happiness of America at any point in time. And I think he would be delighted to see that. And I don't think there's anybody these days, as far as I know, except a few friends. But there was a guy named Fleming who lives in the Midwest, and he thinks that the greatest constitution ever written is the Constitution of the Confederacy. But he's a wild card, to put it mildly. And he's not related to me, incidentally. But at any rate, so he would be delighted, I think, by the state of the country, and he wouldn't be bothered by the quarrels that we're having and so forth. He had some violent quarrels, too. Jefferson, I think, would be really, truly pleased by the spread of liberty, our readiness to extend it to women, to gays, and finally, above all, and this would be a big lesson for Jefferson, because Jefferson did not think that black Americans were capable of having or enjoying liberty. I didn't get into it today because I wrote another book and I published in 2013 called The Disease in the Public Mind. And there I explore Washington's attitude towards the blacks and Jefferson's. And it's very, very strongly different. Washington was convinced almost from the start that blacks were capable of self-government. He enlisted them in the army. Here's a little statistic I bet nobody knows. By 1780, one out of every seven men in the Continental Army, a regular trained soldier, was a black soldier. And this was George Washington's decision to allow them to join the army. Various people in the South had strokes when they heard about it, but he just kept right on saying, no, they're good soldiers, and that's all there is to it. And in this book, in 2013, The Disease in the Public Mind, I call Washington the forgotten emancipator. And he made repeated statements that we had to do something to get rid of slavery, and he freed all his slaves at Mount Vernon in his will. And he would have freed them before he died, I think, but he couldn't persuade even his own wife to agree with him. This was a really difficult thing to convince people that they should accept. And he did his best, but he didn't get anywhere. But he is a forgotten emancipator. And Jefferson, on the other hand, was convinced by he called it scientific evidence and blah, 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 that blacks simply could not deal with freedom, and that's why he persuaded Madison to join him in creating a company that would send all the freed slaves back to Africa. And that's where we got the country of Liberia, and it was a disaster from the word go. The blacks, first of all, black Americans wouldn't go. The freed people, when people came to them and said, oh, come on, we got a boat waiting for you to go to Africa, they said, hey, I'm a free man. I fought here. Some of them could say I fought here for freedom and so forth, and I'm not interested. I want to be free in this country. And there's a huge difference there. But I think even Jefferson now would be awed to see the huge progress of the blacks. And may I interject that, may I drop in a little story to tell you why I know how great it is. I was in the first integrated company in the history of the U.S. Navy. In 1945, when I went to Sampson Naval Training Station in upstate New York, I walked into the barracks and threw my stuff on my bunk, and there was a black man sleeping on my right, there was a black man sleeping on my left, and there was a black man sleeping above me. And what do you know? We got along great. We all realized there was about 40 or 50 black men and about 100 white men in the company. And we all recognized that this was a very important experiment that the Navy was conducting. And we worked at it. We got along great. The guy on my right, I became a very close friend of the man on my right, who slept on my right. And so but it took a long time for this to take root. And we had to go through all sorts of other things. But today, and I hope to write this in an article, a part of a book I'm going to write called Encounters with History. I want to write the whole history. Right now, the military part of the United States, the military organizations, they are the most integrated part of our society. They have totally banished race prejudice. And there are black admirals, black generals, there are black young, talented black men and women graduating from Annapolis and West Point. I've seen them with West Point with my own eyes. And so this has happened in the United States of America. And I think enough Americans don't know about it. And this, I think, would have convinced Jefferson, too. He would have admitted he was wrong.
Thank you.
Okay. As you can see, I get passionate about that stuff. I'll never forget that integrated company. Yes, sir.
I think we've all seen Mount Vernon and Monticello, two big houses.
Oh, yes, yes.
Did that social class of the plantation Virginia society make them have something in common, or were they so politically different that they didn't have?
Well, the difference, that there was a great difference between Monticello and Mount Vernon, and the main reason was Washington was a very good businessman, and Mount Vernon most of the times showed a profit, whereas Monticello never did. Jefferson was a disaster as a businessman, and he did have some very unfortunate things happen to him. His wife inherited a huge amount of debt from her father's estate, and Jefferson was stuck with paying that off for the rest of his life. But nonetheless, that is a basic difference between the two men. And I think that now, what else were we going to talk about?
Kind of plantation society.
Yeah, plantations.
And the upper class.
Excuse me. Yeah, I got slightly distracted there. There's a wonderful book that I recommend very highly. It's called, I don't remember the name of the author, it's called George Washington's Eye, E-Y-E, and it describes how he built Mount Vernon. He was his own architect, and he built this basically comfortable country mansion. And it started off with just this little squat little house, and he added wings, he added a floor above, and he had the shingles treated so they looked like stone. He did all sorts of very interesting touches. He had his own talent as an architect, but he wasn't the magnificent creation of Monticello. Jefferson really was a gifted architect with a capital A, and so they were from very different parts of Virginia. Albemarle County was really on the western frontier when Jefferson was growing up, and Mount Vernon was right in the settled part of Virginia. So they had different ways of thinking about things and so forth. So the fact that they both owned these big houses didn't connect, I think, particularly and giving them any sense of identity. There's just so many other big landowners in Virginia at the time.
Just a comment. We have a book called The Eye of Thomas Jefferson.
Oh,
because,
no kidding.
Yeah, there. Where? What?
That would be very interesting to
read,
I think.
It was the National Gallery in 1976 did a bicentennial exhibit everything in Thomas Jefferson's world.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's
well, this book that I just mentioned, you know, came out last year, is obviously not a reply, but they are showing you that Washington definitely had some talent as an architect and great taste. He really had very good taste. And I think maybe this sums up our talk and our conversation today. And let me tell you how much I enjoyed it.